debilitating, humiliating defeat at Stalingrad in the new year of 1943 was the beginning of the end of Nazi Germany. No more heady, stupendous victories, only vicious, blood-spilling defeats. So much of the best blood had already been spilled in the snow and dust. Germany had precious few men left to spend in this enormous waste of Russian land. In 18 months, she had lost 2,300,000 men. She could not win this kind of war. Russia could. But it would take two more terrible years. The Germans had been dispossessed of the future. There was no great citadel to fall back on, no secure Germany to escape to. There was only attrition and death. As long as they lived, the Germans fought. Some would fight on into 1946, not for the long-lost Nazi cause, but for Ukrainian independence. But all the while, the ranks thinned, and the survivors became the victims, one by one. This was the Russian-German War. Another spring faithfully broke the bounds of winter. Leningrad was still besieged, still numbed by hunger, still cowed by German bombardment. Yet people risked their lives in pathetic attempts to be normal. They swept the streets, washed the windows, shopped in the empty shops, and were cheered to hold out forever if necessary by the mere sight of a tram running again. A German defeat was no longer something everyone prayed for, but something everyone expected. Churchill and Roosevelt met at Casablanca and declared that Germany would not be allowed to do less than surrender unconditionally. Hitler would not be allowed to escape the penalties for what he had done to the world.
Das deutsche Volk wehrt sich gegen die totalen Kriegsmaßnahmen der Regierung. Es will nicht den totalen Krieg, sagen die Engländer, sondern die Kapitulation.
The Nazis responded with a declaration of their own, total war. Goebbels, who was surpassed only by Hitler in his ability to scream Nazi blood into a boil, soared with the challenge as the German fortunes fell. Hitler badly needed a victory, but how, or what, or where? The generals implored him, showered him with plans, plotted for his attention. Tempers burst. Field Marshal von Kluge challenged General Guderian to a duel. At last, the finger pointed to this place, the Kursk salient, a great bulge of Russian troops in the middle of the German line. It began as an idea for an obvious and limited offensive battle and grew into a plan of enormous proportions, but it was only a plan. A nervous and now uncertain Hitler set a date in April and then cancelled it. April passed into May and May into June and June into July before he reluctantly let it happen. As the time passed, the thing got bigger and bigger. As the watches ticked synchronously down to the final hour and the first tank treads broke the soil, the biggest battle of World War II and the most massive tank battle the world would ever see was about to take place. It was no surprise to the Russians. They knew more about Hitler's plan than some of his own generals, the date, the place, the strength, the objective. Seventeen panzer divisions heaved mightily at the Russian line. A few hours later, the Russians heaved back. 20,000 Russian guns ripped the night into shreds of day. 1,000 banks of Katyusha rockets screamed at the Germans. The Germans were enticed into a deadly trap. The Russians left no detail to fortune. Blitzkrieg was the most ingenious and formidable tactic of war ever devised. The Russians found its fatal flaw. Each of its parts had a weakness. The Stukas, the guns, the tanks, the infantry. Each counted on the others to compensate for its weakness. Yet between these layers of firepower, separate them, and the Blitzkrieg could be broken. So the Russians, their guns stilled, their courage unbroken, waited for the tanks to run over them. Then they could get between the panzers and the infantry. Then they could destroy them. The Russians had other new tactics. Anti-tank guns in units of 10 were maneuvered like galleons, their sights training on a single target. Few German tanks survived a broadside from 10 guns. In all, 6,100 tanks fought each other on this enormous battlefield. Both sides lost heavily. The Germans lost irreparably. The panzer armies, the great knife edge of German military strength, were broken. They would never be replaced. The Germans could do no more than dent the Russian defenses. with some of the most skillful and courageous fighting this war had ever seen, they got no deeper than 10 miles, 100 miles short of surrounding the Russians. Hitler had given his enemy the whole spring and part of the summer to prepare for this struggle. The time was not wasted. They built not one, not two, not three, but 8 defensive belts 180 miles deep. When the Germans were stopped, the Russians were ready with a stunning counteroffensive and followed that with a separate full-scale offensive. German estimates of Russian fighting skill had to be revised for the last time. These men were not just courageous. They had survived this terrible struggle long enough to acquire the gut-hard skills which made them the equal of the Germans. Perhaps only the German army could have withstood what the Russians did at Kursk. The SS Panzer divisions, Hitler's pampered specialists, were hammered brutally. Their arrogance was not diminished, only tempered by a fatalism which grew into fanaticism. The very names of these divisions struck fearful, discordant sounds. SS Leibstandarte, SS Das Reich, SS Totenkopf. Totenkopf. The Death's Head Division did not attempt to give up. They knew they would be shot on sight. The Russians celebrated prematurely. But there had been so little reason to cheer in these two terrible, awesome years. As the Germans were pressed back in stubborn retreat, they were harassed without respite by the Russian army behind their lines, the partisans. By now, there were not less than 500,000 of these men and women who roamed the countryside in packs and dogged the Germans like jackals. As towns and villages were abandoned in the retreat, they exploded in hatred. Revenge was not to be sweetened by even the smallest gesture of compassion. For collaborators, partisan justice was swift, unquestioning, and brutal. The evidence of the collaborators' duplicity in aiding the German extermination squads was to be found here. Even those who had believed the very worst were stunned to incredulity. At Babi Yar, they found the bodies of 100,000, most of them Jews. Crimes against humanity? The phrase didn't begin to express the revulsion. In October of 43, the foreign ministers of the Allied powers met in Moscow. For more than 2 years, the Russians had begged the Western countries to make their promised landing on the French coast. Now they were prepared to let the others pretty well take their time. In the words of Vyshinsky, if the autumn leaves should fall in spring, that's okay. The Russians were winning. The Germans had been invincible. They were no longer. Some Russians now thought they could defeat Germany single-handedly. Two-thirds of the occupied territory had been recaptured. It seemed only a matter of pushing on into Germany until it was over. But Stalin knew that his whole country was war-weary. The effort had been colossal, almost superhuman. These people needed something to cheer them on, and an invasion in the West could do that. The three Allied leaders met for the very first time in November in Tehran. Never in all of history have three more powerful or more extraordinary men sat down together to make common cause. The cause was clearly stated in the unminced words of their communique. Our offensive will be merciless and cumulative. Stalin got his promise of a second front. The invasion from the west was planned for May 1944. Reichsfuhrer SS Heinrich Himmler and the others were now troubled. They responded with new plots, double cross, and more murder. The men who had to fight on in the name of Nazism knew the sides had changed. What was happening to Germany was happening to them in the soulless chill of a new Russian winter. As the year turned, the Germans were bludgeoned by an explosive series of Russian offensives. The indomitable Leningrad was suddenly relieved after 880 days of siege. There were 600,000 survivors out of the original 3 million inhabitants. More than a million had escaped. More than a million had died. Hitler ordered his men to stay and fight. As the fury of the Russian shock armies hit them, they fled, abandoning the sick and wounded. In a week, they found themselves not in Russia, but Estonia, heavy with a misery greater than anything they had known in this miserable war. The narrow roads filled up and became traps for hundreds of vehicles. Other Germans went efficiently about the business of destroying anything which could be of use to the Russians. Western Ukraine, on the very day that Hitler had called his generals back to East Prussia to give them a schoolboy lecture on Nazism, the Russians struck hard and surrounded 60,000 men. The wounded were not only abandoned, but in many cases, shot by their own comrades. Some escaped, but according to one Russian account, they left behind them, in a single four-hour battle, 20,000 German dead. Most were butchered by sabers or run over by tanks. Eventually, the pace of fighting slowed, as it had in the previous winters. The Russians were still up against the German army. Some of its members had fought this war from the beginning. They had the tenacity of survivors. They did not die easily or foolishly. Other survivors, most were barely able to speak their horror. The extermination squads had set boastful records. In one place, in 2 days, they had murdered 33,771 people. Hitler still felt he could part the seas and master fate by his own command. Generals begged for retreat. No retreat, said Hitler, and he sacked them. In the Crimea, the Russians again trapped a whole German army. No retreat, The Crimea was lost, and with it more than 100,000 troops. The Germans now employed their genius to scorch the earth in their wake. In some places, there was little left to destroy. In 4 months, the partisans alone blew up the rail lines in 200,000 places, wrecked more than 1,000 trains, more than 800 locomotives. The Germans finished off what was left. D-Day still hadn't happened. But the skies over German territory were filled with the bombs and bombers of the West, the British by night, the Americans by day. One of the prime targets, the long and dangerous run on the Plesti oil fields in Romania, Hitler's last source of natural petroleum. In the eye of this hurricane, German arms production, surprisingly, was rising and would hit its peak in this year of 1944. The tail was now turned round, and it was the German nation which was being mobilized for survival. The work went on round the clock. Few were too old or too young to escape recruitment, except women. Hitler, with his peculiar old-fashioned view of the delicacy of the female, would not let them become laborers. Even Russian prisoners, who until now had been left to waste to death in the slow agony of starvation, were raised up to the rank of slave laborers and fed enough to sustain them in a pitiful day's work. The Hitler Youth, its senior ranks getting younger and younger, assembled parts for the weapons which would soon be theirs. The only Germans hard-pressed for something to do were among the 2.5 million men held down in the West, waiting for the Americans, British, and Canadians to invade. They made toys by the tens of thousands for the children they had left behind them, and proudly and happily posed for the German newsreel cameras. The Russians made some toys of their own. The miniature Goliath tank filled with explosive. Germany's fate was fixed in June of 1944. No one, not even Hitler, from that time on could have any doubt of what the end would be. The Channel invasion on the 6th of June caught the Germans by surprise. They would never recover enough to throw the invaders back into the sea. On June 22nd, 3 years to the very day that they had been surprised by the Germans, the Russians doubled the D-Day blow with a massive offensive of their own. They attacked with 166 divisions on a front of 450 miles. Whole German divisions, corps, armies were surrounded, overwhelmed, swept away, and disappeared. 300,000 men were lost. 57,000 of those who lived were marched through Red Square. The Russians pointedly washed down the pavement after they had gone. The Russians raced across the Polish border without pause for celebration. They crossed the great rivers of Central Europe. These had been the start lines for the Germans when they began this war in the East more than 3 years before. Almost the whole of the German army in the center was gone, destroyed. The way was open in a straight line from Kursk, where the panzer armies had been smashed, through Warsaw, to the object of everyone's revenge, Berlin. At Lublin, a cabbage patch. All around was evidence of an evil so great that no one has ever found words to express it. The cabbages had been fertilized with the remains of 1.5 million human beings, all murdered at the nearby death camp of Majdanek. The victims had been gassed in concrete chambers, then their corpses burned to a white ash. Gold was extracted from their teeth and sent to the Reichsbank. Their belongings, from shoes to teddy bears, were sorted and packed and shipped to be sold cheap to German civilians. Camp guards ate the cabbages. Majdanek was the first death camp captured. Except for the Russian soldiers who saw it with their own eyes, no one believed it. Surely it was only Russian propaganda. This insignificant-looking little man had philosophized and commanded the murders at Majdanek. Now he was determined to take more millions to the grave with him. Germany was finished. To the west, to the south, to the east, Hitler's soldiers were in retreat, even full flight. The armies were lost. The war was lost. Even Germany was lost if he wasn't stopped now. But Hitler could and did prolong the killing for almost a year until he himself was gone. If we cannot conquer, we shall drag half the world into destruction with us. As evidence of the man's awesome power over so many Germans, the defense slowly stiffened and grew tenacious, even fanatical. Hatred swept the battlefields of the East with an even greater force than before. In August, the people of Warsaw turned on the Germans with bare-handed force and tried to throw them out. The uprising was encouraged by the Polish government in exile in London. Hitler exploded in rage. He ordered Warsaw wiped from the face of the earth. He ordered his army to stand aside. In went men he knew would deal the Poles a soulless cruelty. SS police units, a brigade of white Russians, a regiment of convicted criminals. Lost 300,000 people, men, women, children, all dead or about to die. Few of those who were marched away, a German promise of fair treatment ringing in their ears, lived to see the end of the war. The Russians had stood by and had done little to help. The bitterness and accusations of both sides run on into history. In the south, the Russians stormed into the Balkan states. Romania collapsed. Bulgaria collapsed. There was an uprising in Slovakia. Only a few Hungarians fought on as Hitler's allies. In the north, in the Baltic, Finland had at last dropped out and made a humiliating peace with Russia. East Prussia was next, the first real piece of German territory the Russians would reach. The defenders prepared for the worst. East Prussia would soon be wiped from existence and cease to be a home for Germans. Berliners did what they had done for a long time, cleaned up the rubble after the bombs had fallen. The raids on the city had a heavy effect on the morale of the men in the front lines. Not only did they face death, but their families chanced dying at home. Still, Hitler would not let them build the defenses against the onrushing armies. That was bad for morale. But the Volkssturm was beginning to organize. That motley, pathetic collection of old men and young boys who would defend Berlin until it and they were no more. Nature, set in her inexorable ways, took no notice of conquerors or conquered. The rains turned the earth to mud, and men cursed and prayed again for cold, forgetting that it would bring winter, one more terrible winter. along the Baltic coast of East Prussia, all through the winter, civilians fled by every means and route they could. 1.5 million went west to escape the Russians. The German armies moved in the opposite direction, to the east, to man the first defenses the Russians would strike on German soil. Russians were coming with forces of unimaginable size and strength. 74 armies, 743 divisions, 15,000 tanks, 15,000 planes. Except for the weather and the unexpected stubbornness of the German resistance, they might have gone to the heart of Berlin without pause. Warsaw was taken at last, and the Russians pivoted north of the city to surround and strangle East Prussia. Through one 15-mile-wide hole punched in the German defenses, the Russians poured, in a single day, 400,000 men. In the Berlin Sports Palace, its roof gone, a gray chill in the air, Germans tried to lift their spirits. Some soldiers had no hands to clap, no feet to stomp. They'd lost them in the Russian winter. Berliners were spending less and less time in the streets and more time underground. The city administration went underground. Government departments went underground. The propaganda ministry continued to prepare and print its strident messages as if nothing had happened, nothing had changed. Many of these people would drown when Hitler, in the last days, ordered the underground flooded. The three Allied leaders met again in February at Yalta. The task now was not to plot the winning of the war, that was inevitable. It was to decide how they would divide up Europe and how they would run the world. The three were a greater contrast than ever. Roosevelt was a shadow of the man he had been. The spirit had left him, and he would be dead in a few weeks. Churchill carried with him his undiminished suspicions of the communists. Stalin, poised finally in a position of enormous strength and power, was prepared to talk and bargain and be complimentary and get most of what he wanted. And he knew, perhaps more than the others, exactly what he wanted. He showed as he talked that he understood and could foresee exactly what would happen after Germany was finished. The difficult task, he said, will come after the war, when diverse interests tend to divide the Allies. The three could not have known how they set the course of world history for the next 25 years. The Germans, now desperate for men, began to look with some eagerness on the Russian army within their own ranks, the army of General Vlasov. Vlasov and the others had been given a brutal option: fight for Germany or starve to death. The more the merrier for Goebbels. If Will could win the war, Goebbels would win it all by himself. He seemed to relish the experience of Germany in her death throes. The people of East Prussia relished none of it. While the German troops were driven back on the Baltic coast, Russian hatred burst on the civilian population. Rape, murder, looting, burning. It would be weeks before the generals and the commissars could get control of their men. Things in Hitler's presence had taken on aspects of the Mad Hatter's Tea Party. Since some of his generals had blown him up in his bunker the summer before, his whole personality had been steeped in a sea of paranoia. He had extracted 4,000 executions for that assassination attempt. Many of the victims were strung up by piano wire and hanged from meat hooks. He now trusted no one. Those who wanted to stay alive had to pay him enthusiastic deference. The last great tragedy of this war was that it had to go on when it should have been over. More thousands were to die, even more needlessly than the millions who had died before them.
Артиллерия сделала свое дело, обеспечила проходы.
As the Russians swept through western Poland and took the cities of Poznan and Breslau, they captured another 91,000 Germans. Berlin was just 120 kilometers, and the way was opening up. Berliners at last began to prepare themselves and their defenses. By now, they were not strangers to danger. It lurked everywhere. Hitler made his last public appearance. Perhaps the only pathetic scene we will ever see of the man. Dragging one foot, one arm nearly useless, his body racked by drugs, marshalling phantom armies in the darkened recesses of his mind, playing father to the children who would defend the Third Reich to the death. Russians reached the Baltic, west of Königsberg. The port city became a besieged fortress for tens of thousands of trapped Germans. New flags flew above the ruins all over Eastern Europe. In Königsberg, the old men and the young boys waited to do the duty which had at last come to them. Thousands of civilians, knowing the greatest armies in history were driving on Berlin from two sides, fled to Königsberg. From there, many escaped by sea. Some of the defenders gave up easily. Others fought on with a tenacity barely matched by the fanatics of the SS. Königsberg held out almost as long as Berlin. There were 84,000 prisoners, 42,000 dead. Berlin was next and last. 3.5 million men, 52,000 guns, 7,750 tanks, 11,000 planes, all ready on both sides to blow this enormous city to the ground and incinerate the Third Reich in a holocaust of fiery ruin and destruction. 40,000 tons of shells exploded from the guns, 65,000 tons rained down from the skies. We'll be right back. ubiquitous Marshal Zhukov was there to share command of this, the greatest military force in history. Hundreds square miles of the city were burned, gutted, bombed, broken into useless ruin. Some of the young boys, children, fought with a disturbing, desperate, frightening courage. Memories of them would haunt soldiers for years after. Then it was over. There was one final absurdity, an obscene and cruel one. The rubble was studded with the bodies of fake Hitlers. Germans with the misfortune to look like the man had been dressed up, made up, and shot by the Gestapo. There were other bodies. Goebbels, his wife, their six children. The adults dead by suicide, the children poisoned. Among the unfortunate fakes, the real Hitler was not found, was never found. The war had passed on, suddenly, abruptly, like a summer storm. It had stopped. It was over. It was calm, even silent. The nightmare was gone, and it was history. The papers had to be signed. The new heroes, the generals who had maneuvered colossal armies and mastered the victory, now seemed strangely out of place. One wanted them behind schoolmasters' desks, or drugstore counters, or on golf courses. The only disturbing presence in the room was that of Wilhelm Keitel, the Prussian field marshal. He looked the part he played. Yet unlike the men who confronted him, he was never much of a soldier. Even Hitler had called him a blockhead. And now he signed, because he had to. Can't perceive the meaning or imagine the suffering. We can only count the cost of this Russian-German war. 25 million dead. 17,800 killed for each of the 1,400 days that it lasted. Maybe there were some lessons learned. Perhaps it was the awesome beginning to the end to war. We don't know. There are only questions. How could it happen? Was any of it worth the precious lives of 25 million people?